Jerome Ringo grew up among the rivers and bayous of Louisiana.
In Louisiana, you never live far away from the marshes or the bayous or nature. No matter where you live, you're close by. So it was very easy to be well connected to nature by simply taking a walk a block or two from your house, and you're on the bayou under the Spanish moss and the oak trees. And so being connected to nature was a pretty simple thing. It was easy. But it was a good life. It was a simple life. We were country folk, and everyone knew each other, and we were connected to nature. But, you know, it took a village to raise the kids, and it was the villages that were involved. Everyone was involved in raising every young adult within the community. We were engaged in church in a big way. All kids went to church. It was a mandatory. It was mandated by the parents that we did so. The chemical industry is the largest employer in the state of Louisiana, so I ended up spending over 20 years in the petrochemical industry. Well, I recognize that in those communities that were close to the plant, the cancer rates were higher than the national average. The last 5 years of my industry life was working overseas in the petrochemical industry in Malaysia for the same company that I was working for here. So I had an experience of seeing environmental exploitation at a different level. And it was a really eye-opener for me that the level of environmental exploitation made its way outside the borders of the United States into other countries, into other poor communities as well. And that was sort of the driver that just led me to try something different. So I made a decision years after that it was time to get out and work for the people on the other side of the fence.
The other side of the fence for Ringo meant joining the Louisiana Wildlife Federation, the largest environmental organization in the state.
Unfortunately, I had no idea when I joined that the organization had 24,000 members, that I would be the only black member.
He became vice president of the federation and was later asked to run for the board of directors for the National Wildlife Federation. And in 2007, Ringo became the first African American in history to head a conservation organization.
There had to be a level of success that I had to achieve more than by virtue of my presence. I had to not only be the first, but I had to be good at being the first.
And why, according to Jerome Ringo, was it necessary to be the African American pioneer for the Wildlife Federation?
Two out of three African Americans live within the same zip code of a landfill. If you ever want to find a black neighborhood, you find a railroad track. And railroad tracks frequent hazardous materials, and they park those rail cars in our neighborhoods. 70% of African Americans live within a county that is in violation of the Clean Water or Clean Air Act. So we are clearly disproportionately impacted, but we are clearly not involved. We've got to have a place at the table as a community where these policies and decisions are made that are going to impact our lives environmentally for decades to come.
And where do we start to address the challenges?
The church is the place for African Americans to start, because we have a moral obligation to the environment. When God gave man dominion over the earth, he didn't say take dominion and trash it. I'm really interested in reaching the young people and that next generation. They're going to inherit this problem of a poor environment, but they're also going to inherit the responsibility to fix it. Water is a major challenge now and will be a greater challenge in the future, because of water shortages. And it's a challenge that our young people are going to face at a much larger scale than we face today. So we've got to prepare our next generations to deal with these issues and face them head on.
Ringo and his wife still live in Louisiana on a large piece of land that is also the location for his wife's ministry. They have a blended family of four children and have made great plans to grow the Faith Vision non-denominational ministries into a place for Christians, especially young people, to gather and study.
We look at our lives as being a living testimony of what can be done with a can-do spirit, and we're excited about what God has chosen us to do.
While he is no longer leading the Wildlife Federation, Ringo is still active in environmental strategy, partnering with others in exploring a new fuel for ships from algae.
The earth is in critical condition right now, and I do not believe that God intended it to be this way. And we're the life support. And we, as the caretakers of the earth, given by God in Genesis, have a responsibility to save this earth, to fix what has been broken. Surely God, by the swipe of his hand, could fix it. But God wants to test our obedience. He wants to see if we're really going to do as he has said that we should do, and that is be that caretaker of the earth, be the gatekeeper. And we are, and we should. But I think that all that are involved or that are impacted by poor environmental practices have a greater stake in the whole issue. We as people of color and poor people and people within the church have every reason to be involved. We should reactivate activism within the church, within our community, within our schools. Churches have a special responsibility, but yet even a special opportunity, because churches reach masses of people. We have an opportunity to put that passion into the hearts and minds of people, to drive policies, to drive initiatives, to drive those things that are correct. And saving our planet for next generations is the moral and correct thing to do. And no better place or no better catalyst to drive this initiative than from the pulpit, than from ministries, than from our churches. What an opportunity that simply cannot be missed.
Jerome Ringo, one of Earth's caretakers.